This is a simple website. Nothing too special, just some HTML and CSS. And this is the server that's running it. Don't believe me? Here, let's see if this helps. And let's give that a refresh. Yep, that's more like it. To be clear, it's not just that the page layout is defined by those cubes. The Portal 2 engine itself is hosting the server. In this video, we'll take a look at how this even works, what you have to do to make Portal 2 serve a website, and explore a few of the possibilities that this provides. First things first, why is a source engine even capable of doing something like this? Why should a game be able to host a website? Well, in most cases, it shouldn't. Sure, some games may expose a simple browser for displaying news or updates, but that's about it. Okay, so if it's not a built-in server, then how does this work? The protocol used for serving websites is called HTTP, or Hypertext Transfer Protocol. As the name implies, the protocol is designed to transfer text, which makes it incredibly simple and versatile. In theory, all you need in order to run a web server is a network socket capable of transferring text. Well, sort of. See, HTTP runs on top of another protocol called TCP. TCP stands for Transmission Control Protocol, and being the control protocol means it's very careful. It ensures that each packet makes it to the right place and in the right order. But this isn't favorable for real-time applications like video games, because having to watch out for and fix these package ordering issues takes up valuable time. This is where UDP comes in. It has absolutely no regard for order and integrity, instead just bombarding the target with everything it's got. This is great for real-time applications like streaming and video games, but not so much for websites. So before we even consider serving HTTP from Portal 2, we first have to get it to communicate using TCP. If we take a look at all the network sockets the game is using, it's not too surprising to find that the vast majority of these are UDP. There is one TCP connection, but that's outbound for communication with Steam. If we want a socket we can control, we'll have to dig a bit deeper. The Linux versions of the Left 4 Dead dedicated servers shipped with a few unique launch options for easier server management. One of these options is Dash Netcon port, which creates a TCP server that exposes the developer console. As it turns out, this launch option has actually remained in the source engine for future Valve games, including Portal 2. By setting this launch option, you can send commands to the developer console and read their output as promised. But what about HTTP? What happens if we try to connect to the socket as if it were a website? Well, the browser is stuck loading, but the Portal 2 console seems to receive a lot of garbage in the form of HTTP headers. This means that we do have a fully functioning server, it just isn't responding with valid HTTP. Let's see what we can do about that. As I mentioned, the HTTP headers that the browser is sending seem to be getting interpreted as console commands. For context, a header is just some property that describes the data being sent. In this case, we seem to be getting the request type, followed by headers like host, user agent, and so on. But get isn't a valid command, and neither is host or user agent. Even if they were, that wouldn't be particularly helpful. We need a way to forge a custom response to one of these non-existent commands. Specifically, we should probably respond to the very first one to avoid the other errors from confusing the browser. For this, we can use the alias command. It allows us to mask a different command under a custom name. In this case, we can alias get to print some text to the console. To make this a bit easier, I'll implement the logic in VScript. That's the system used for creating various scripted events throughout the game. It's actually a fairly powerful system and is more than enough for what we need to do. I'm using a library called ppmod to make the code a bit cleaner, and this lets us directly attach a script function to the get alias. Inside of the script function, I'm just printing a very basic HTTP response to the console. Again, it's all just plain text, so the browser should have no problem treating this as a valid response. However, when I actually start up a map and open up my browser, it's still stuck loading, even though the console output looks to be correct. It's not until we check the network tab and cancel the request that we see something resembling the desired output, with some more console garbage below. See, normally, after the whole document has been sent, the server would terminate the connection to let the browser know that nothing else is coming and that it's safe to start rendering. But in our case, the console socket never closes. The browser has no idea when to stop listening for output. It reads our example page, then all the garbage, and then continues waiting for even more data. Now, we could terminate the socket by shutting down the game, but surely there's a less destructive option. Well, it turns out that we can make the browser close the connection after a certain amount of data has been received. This can be done with the content length header, which, as the name implies, tells the browser the length of the document in bytes. Most modern browsers will respect this property and stop receiving data as soon as the target amount has been reached. So, in our case, as long as we just count the amount of bytes we're sending, the browser can take care of the rest. Okay, so that's a start, but what is this really good for? Well, remember, this is the Portal 2 engine itself sending the HTTP data. It's actually pretty trivial to make it read data from the game and send that instead of just some static text. For an example, let's try sending the name of the current map file. For that, we first have to calculate the content length of the potential output and then send the map name as part of the output string. Now, if I restart the map and refresh the web page, it'll pull the map name directly from the engine. You could even track objects in the game world like this. Suppose we want the website to tell you whether a cube is on the left or right side of a room. We can get that cube's x-coordinate, compare it to a known value, and print the respective text. And again, loading up the page for the first time, it'll correctly report the cube as being on the right. But if I go ahead and move it to the other side of the room, then refresh the page again, the text will have changed. Hopefully, you're starting to get the idea, but there are some obvious limitations to this. For one, the calculation for the content length is starting to become pretty complicated. Since it would be very impractical to manually calculate the value for every change we make, we can instead just hold the page content in one pre-built string and then use the length of that string as the total content length. That works pretty well and allows us to print even more dynamic values, like the cube's actual coordinates in 3D space. But this now exposes another limitation. You have to refresh the page to actually see the content update. This is where JavaScript comes into play. It's a programming language used for making websites more dynamic. We could use it to automatically refresh the page, but that's not a very clean solution. Instead, for dynamically updating page content, websites usually fetch an API endpoint. You can think of this as just a special address on the server that returns some consistently formatted data. But in our case, we can't actually read the address. The Portal 2 console only interprets the first word of a line as the alias, and discards the rest. There just is no way to tell what address was being fetched, but we can distinguish between different request types. GET is just one of a few. It's the default request type used by a browser trying to get the contents of some document. But if we fetch using a different request type with JavaScript, that can now have its own unique alias. This approach is a bit cursed, but it allows us to effectively implement different routes for data. In this case, I'm just hijacking the POST request type to send some JSON data containing the position of the cube as a string. Then, I can write some JavaScript that fetches this endpoint every second and updates the text on the page. But now if we go to run it, the text seems to disappear entirely. Checking the source of the page, we find that the closing script tag is cut short, and the browser automatically generates one on top of it. Evidently, our content length is being calculated incorrectly, and I think this happens because of the different types of newline characters. Let me explain. Basically, the history of computers is a bit of a mess. Although nowadays a new line is most of the time indicated by just one line feed character, it used to be common practice to also add a carriage return character afterwards. This idea stems from the way a typewriter works. Moving down one line and sending the cursor back to the start of the page are two separate actions, and therefore require two separate characters. Of course, modern computers don't need to be told to reposition the cursor after each new line, but in some places, including the Source Engine Developer Console, this standard has annoyingly stuck around. Long story short, to fix this issue, we just need to count each new line character twice, once for the original line feed and another time for the carriage return. Refreshing the page now, we get a different error, but that's just from my own typo, so after refreshing the page again, the position gets printed to the screen, with live updates in 1 second intervals. At this point, we have all the building blocks you'd ever need to build a full web application. And web apps aren't limited to just text. Here's a demo where I made a small rectangle move left and right based on the cube's position in the game world. And about the address thing, if you wanted to implement custom subpages, you could have some JavaScript on the landing page read the contents of the address bar and fetch the corresponding API endpoint. And just so that you're not limited by request types, you could also index different endpoints by using custom headers. That's right, the headers aren't necessarily predefined. You can send and receive custom ones, which in our case means literally sending custom commands to the game. The possibilities are virtually endless. In fact, when I first discovered this, I made a fully functional mini-map that would display the terrain in real time and even let you move the player by pressing buttons in the browser. But okay, let's be honest, there are easier ways to visualize information coming from the game. This is a web server after all, so how about we use it for its intended purpose? Serving a website. The idea is simple. Create a system that maps objects in-game to elements in a website. Ideally, this system would be modular enough to allow for creating almost any website. And to figure out how to do this, let's take a quick look at what makes up a website. This is an HTML file. It's basically the code of a website, and while we could make a system where each cube corresponds to one character of this file, that would be much too annoying. And at the end of the day, we're building a website, not a text editor, so instead, this file can be interpreted using a more abstract form, the Document Object Model, or DOM. In this form, we're no longer dealing with individual characters, but rather discrete objects that represent HTML tags. If we then map these objects to cubes in the game world, we can start to represent a whole entire website by just stacking these cubes next to each other. For example, let's say I want to build a website with just the text subscribe in it. I've added a script command that lets me create the different types of tags as colored storage cubes. If I set down an opening and closing header tag, then put down a cube representing the text in between those tags, our website will now reflect that object model. If I wanted to add an image below that, I can literally just create another cube with the image tag. And lastly, to add style modifiers, I can create special modifier cubes and stack them on top of the target element. With just these core concepts, you can start to build a simple web page. And that's exactly how I built the site from this video's intro, literally stacking blocks one by one. Now, of course, this quickly becomes impractical for larger websites. Even while building this one, it eventually became hard to stack the cubes any higher. But just for the sake of the argument, what would a modern website look like in this form? Well, to answer that question, I wrote a few scripts for converting any relatively simple website to the corresponding arrangement of cubes. I was gonna try parsing the front page of Google, but it turns out that it's actually not as lightweight as it looks. The total cube count exceeds the total entity limit of Portal 2, so I used the homepage of another search engine, DuckDuckGo, instead. This is what it looks like if you parse just the HTML, without any style modifiers. It's a pretty colorful scene, definitely more complex than my example from earlier, but it also doesn't look too coherent when opened in a browser. And this is what happens when we add all the style modifiers. I have to do this slowly, one by one, because of the sheer amount of cubes in each iteration. The engine just can't keep up otherwise. Of course, there are more efficient ways to represent CSS, but I decided to map each one property to one cube, because that kind of follows the same atomic concept as the document itself. Even so, the resulting page isn't completely accurate to the original. The DuckDuckGo homepage uses Base64 images, which are basically long strings of text containing the entire image data. In fact, this text is longer than the longest permitted console command, which is why the algorithm just ignores it. The other issues stem from an incomplete DOM representation, but I honestly can't be brought to care enough to fix it. The pillar here actually extends outside of the map, and the only reason it's not toppling over or crashing my game is because I've completely disabled physics simulation. But, of course, just for fun, let's see what happens if we do enable physics, but disable gravity, and fire a rocket at the cubes. The game actually performs better than I expected, mostly because disabling the gravity leads to fewer collisions overall. And unsurprisingly, this completely ruins the page layout. Anyway, I'll leave the destruction on screen for a while longer, but otherwise, that's all from me. Thanks for watching. By the way, at least on the Linux version, Portal 2 does actually have a built-in web server. It just doesn't output anything other than 404 not found, so it's completely useless, but fun bit of trivia nonetheless.